Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to begin our second session on this beautiful Tuesday morning. It's the Global Beans Outlook, and I would like to acknowledge our sponsor for this session, Societa Kofika, worldwide exporters of pulse crops and other products from Melbourne, Australia. So I'm going to introduce the moderator for this panel. And today we have the honor and privilege actually to have as our moderator Joe Kramer. Mr. Kramer has spent the past 30 years in the dry bean industry, spending 27 of those as vice president of the edible bean division of Star of the West Milling Company, based in Frankenmuth, Michigan. During his tenure, he served two terms as president of the U.S. Dry Bean Council, and he now serves as the executive director as of the Michigan Bean Commission. The commission represents all of Michigan's dry bean growers who are focused on dry bean agronomic and nutrition research and market promotion for Michigan's high-quality dry beans. Joe is also one of my board members, serving as a director on the American Pulse Association, and he voted in favor of becoming a major sponsor of this event. So please join me in welcoming the moderator for the Global Bean Outlook panel, Mr. Joe Kramer.
Good morning, everyone. It's an honor for me to be here today, and I have the privilege of starting with by introducing our speaker that's going to kick off the Global Bean Outlook, Dr. Randy Fairman. Dr. Fairman developed an appreciation for scientific research and technology insertion during his doctoral studies at MIT. His background in numerical analysis, engineering, and fact-based decision-making serves him well in navigating the complexities of international business and the agricultural industries. In partnership with the International Food Trader Network, Dr. Fairman contributes insight from farmers, processors, and exporters with cross-reference customs data corroborated in his market analysis on pulses. Dr. Fairman lives and works in the agriculture industry in Northwest China, managing his company, consulting company, Fairman International Business Consulting. Dr. Fairman, welcome to the stage.
I can't imagine a more nerve-wracking scenario, being introduced by somebody with 30 years of experience and following the only member of the Pulse Statistics Hall of Fame, Brian Clancy. But here we are. 8 months ago, we started a research project where we wanted to look at the last 10 years of the dry bean industry trade, and we were invited by the speakers committee here to prepare for this and speak here. So I'm appreciating that. So if you look, so I'm a numbers guy. It's what I do. I love numbers. When I see a page of numbers, it's a lot of stories waiting to be told. And so although I only have 3 years specifically in the pulse industry, I've got a good background in numbers, and most of what I'm saying today has come from you guys, the people with experience. So a big part of the story today in the bean industry is people like Mr. Chen. Mr. Chen grows 1 ton of pulses, 1 ton of beans in China, and there's thousands upon thousands of Mr. Chens out there making decisions about what they're going to plant based on information that's a lot different than the information that we have here. So when we look at the statistics databases and the methods of decision making, we need to remember that Mr. Chen doesn't even have a bank account, he has a bean account. He harvests his 1 ton of beans, and he stores them under his bed, and when it's time to get some money, he opens up his bean account and cashes it in. And so right now in China, there's hundreds of thousands of tons in Mr. Chen's bean account, and that's gonna play into the global picture. So our outline today is basically looking at the intercontinental trade overview. This is sort of the study that we've done for the last 8 months looking at worldwide trends. And then the second thing is going to be looking at two specific areas of the bean industry, the black beans and the white beans. And The news on that is so different. I can't imagine how it would be different than the lentil picture. That right now there are hundreds of thousands of tons of stock available, and I'm not clear where it's going to go. And so we'll talk about those. And then there's two areas that are a little bit more balanced, which is the red beans and the speckled beans. And finally, we'll mention the fava beans. So this eight-month study that we did, essentially we looked at the international trade databases, and the first thing that the industry members told me is you can't trust the numbers, that the statistics databases are wrong, you can't trust the numbers, and so the first step we did is try to figure out what's right and what's wrong, what can we validate. And if you look at the various blocks here, we looked at the exports from Argentina and the imports to Europe. And we said over a given six-month period, how well do the export claims and the import claims match? And we found that when it comes to dollars, it doesn't match very well. When it comes to tons, it actually matches quite well. And so we feel pretty confident that for these large white line shipments, that that those large intercontinental shipments over the ocean, that the tonnage is a pretty good predictor. For the cross-land shipment or the regional trade, there's a lot of variations. The border trade with India is one area. Argentina, Brazil has some. There's a lot of places in the world where cross-border trade maybe doesn't go into the computational model. Another thing that we found during this study is that the regional trade compared to the intercontinental trade is not very similar. That, for example, if you look at this particular picture, this is South America. On the left-hand side, you've got the regional trade within South America, and obviously it's dominated by black beans. On the right-hand side, you've got the intercontinental trade that's happening from Argentina to the rest of the world other than South America. And obviously it's dominated by white, red, speckled kidney bean trade. So this pattern actually plays out throughout the world, whether it's India or whichever region, that the things that are being traded locally across the borders and in the local region are very different than what's being traded to the rest of the world. Here's the global picture of the trade between the blocks. So if you look at the left-hand diagram, the orange at the bottom, that's the trade to Europe. So the intercontinental shipments by destination, you can see the trade to Europe. Essentially, they're going to eat 450,000 tons worth of beans, and they're going to import all of them. And so it's pretty flat over those years. South America is the gray, and if you look at that section, you can see it varies a lot according to what's happening with the local production. And then the other ones are there too. On the right-hand side, the biggest story in that picture is obviously China. The trade in 2013, there was a tremendous flood that basically knocked out hundreds of thousands of tons, and that brought down the 2013 and 2014 data. And then even once the 2014 crop came in, it just hasn't really been shipping very strong yet. So that's the overview for all the coloreds. Here's another way to split up that same graph. You see the numbers are the same, but this just shows what color the beans are that are being traded. So for the red and the white beans, those are the ones, a lot of those are going to Europe. And so it's pretty level for the intercontinental trade on the red and white beans. And then the speckleds and the blacks have a lot more variation. So there's not a lot of decision-making material there, but it's a background to what the overall industry looks like. Now we kind of come to the next area, which is two specific colors of beans where currently there is a lot of beans out there. The worldwide black bean trade picture can be summarized in this chart, that essentially the 10-year average of beans coming from Northeast China to South America is 223,000 tons. Argentina averages somewhere around 125,000 tons, and then there's 85,000 tons just being traded within the North American free trade area. So that's the big picture of what the black bean industry looks like. And so within that, you have this current situation where the worldwide total is something like 1.5 million tons of black beans. In 2014, a conservative estimate, we're a couple hundred thousand tons above the 10-year average. I would say the 10-year average is a good estimate of real worldwide demand. And so we have a couple hundred thousand tons in 2014 above the worldwide demand. A lot of those are sitting underneath Mr. Chen's bed. In 2015, we've been talking to Chinese farmers, and they're telling us that they're not going to plant black beans, but they're going to plant some. They're not really going to plant none. So I've modeled it to be dropping significantly, and still, with the North American planting intentions, with the Argentina crop, with Mexico, we're still looking at a further increase in black bean production this year. And so I think the reality is the black bean market has a lot of beans, and I'm not sure what's going to happen to that. One question that I'm looking forward to hearing from the panel on is the South American bean situation. If you look, this chart shows the average number of tons over it's kind of a trailing 12-month average. So starting in 2011 up through October 2013, there was always 328,000 tons or more coming into the South American bloc from elsewhere. And from the time of that that flooding disaster in China until now, it's gone down to 60%, by 60% of what it was, and it's not really showing signs of picking up. So the question is South America just going to provide for their own black beans now? Is this a glitch? Is this a temporary drop? Or is it a big change that the industry has to address? I think my overall picture to describe the black bean industry is in this diagram. I don't know where the tornado is going to hit. I can say 5 years ago, there was a huge drought in South America, and at that time there was a huge stock of Chinese black beans, and they went to South America. And it sort of cleared up the disaster a little bit. 2 years ago, October 2013, there was hundreds of thousands of tons of beans destroyed in the Chinese fields, and that sort of cleaned up that disaster. And so in those cases, the tornado hit South America, and then the tornado hit China, and then in 2014, we've just got a lot of beans. And if 2015 plays out the same way, I think that there's going to be some hard decisions that need to be made. For the white bean industry, we have a more complicated picture. The North American white bean trade, you can see the biggest candidate goes to Europe. I've got free access to all of these reports, so you don't have to memorize it. There's 48,000 metric tons going from Argentina to Europe on average, with a bunch going to Africa as well, and then China is supplying a lot to Europe and Asia. So for the white bean outlook, the average over the last, the sort of notional average is somewhere around 750,000 tons worldwide, and in 2014 we had something like 810,000 tons. And in 2015 it's still looking like there's likely to be overplanting. So right now I estimate that Mr. Chen has about 60,000 tons worth of white beans sitting under his bed in his bean account waiting to be purchased, waiting for the price to be right. One of the things that came out of the study we did was we looked at the overall trends, and if you look on the left-hand side here, you can see that North America has been progressively taking over the white bean market. A lot of that's in response to the drought that happened in South America and the flooding in China, but it kind of looks like the demand is rather constant, but the North American share is going up, and the question is, can North America keep China's share of the white bean market? What's going to happen there? That'll be another interesting question to explore. So with that, we've got the black beans and the white beans. I think that's the part of it that has the strongest oversupply. And now the red beans, it's a little bit better story. The North American red kidney bean trade has around 30,000 tons going to Europe, and the China red bean trade has like 36,000 tons going to Europe and 15,000 tons going to India, and then Argentina is more around 15,000 tons historically. So if you look at the average column here, the average says something like 205,000 tons. Now that has, within that, some droughts and some crop problems. It's maybe on the low side of what we would see the consumption as, but in 2014, there was something like 275,000 tons produced, a huge amount of red beans. And in the last fall when the crops were coming in, I was telling my clients, you know, I think you should be careful here because there are a lot of red beans. And I expected that there would be a precipitous price drop, but actually it hasn't materialized. Right now, the shipments out of China for dark red kidney beans are on track to deplete their stock by the new year. That the rate of shipments from China is quite good. The rate of shipments from everywhere else is quite good. And the price really hasn't crashed the way I thought it would. I think based on the problems with the other beans and the lack of good alternatives that 2015 is going to see a further increase. And I think that we'll see what happens in 2016. It might be the case where I think they said high prices destroy high prices. I could see that it could possibly happen that the price comes down because of higher production next year. This is one interesting map that I came up with. You have 2011, 12, 13, and 14 shipments to Europe. And so it looks like the European demand for red beans is growing year on year. And perhaps that can account for why it is that as the production has gone up, the price hasn't fallen out. Maybe this is an area where there's an elastic demand that's going to come up to meet the production. For the North American speckled bean trade, the bulk majority of North American speckled beans are pinto beans, and they're being consumed in North America. The ones that are being exported are some pinto beans and cranberry beans. The ones to Europe are mainly cranberry beans. The China speckled bean trade, the biggest portion is light speckled kidney beans being sent to Asia and Africa, with a smaller amount of cranberry beans being sent to Europe. And then the Argentine speckled bean trade is almost solely the cranberry beans. So for the speckled bean outlook, the China light speckled kidney beans in 2014, somewhere around 200,000 tons. The cranberry beans, you can see the numbers. But in the grand scheme of things, it looks like the 2014 production of speckled kidney beans is something like on the order of magnitude of the notional demand. And for 2015, the North American pinto bean planting, from everything I've seen, it looks like the plantings are going to be lower. And so this is an area where the supply and demand, in my outlook, might be closer to balanced for speckled kidney beans. One of the things that I noticed about the speckled kidney beans is that we already talked about how the black bean is extremely down right now. You can see in this chart that the speckled kidney beans have sort of been steadily decreasing over time, and the question is, what's causing that? I'm not 100% clear. I've got a lot of guesses, but I think the panel will probably be able to answer it clearly. Basically, it's South Africa and India have traditionally been the importers of the Chinese speckled beans, and the pinto beans have been part of that as well. Going back to this picture, I think a sort of summary of the worldwide bean trade here, back to this previous slide, is that you have one slice that is pure demand. That's Europe. It's basically the red and the white beans. And then you have another slice that is countries that provide a lot of their own beans, and then other countries are filling in as the demand comes up or a drought happens or whatever else. And so that's sort of the overview there. For the fava beans, we polled a number of people, and it looks like the overall direction with fava beans is growing, that there's increasing demand, increasing supply, and the one thing of interest is Canada. Canada has really started to take off in the fava bean industry, and it looks like there could be potentially a very large possibility for that to grow. So it'll be interesting to see where that goes. So this, I've put our 8-month report here into 30 minutes and 5 beans, and we have the entire thing online. If you want, there's a couple people handing out brochures in here that have a free access to the entire study that we did that includes all these numbers and a lot more. And so with that, I'll turn it over to our moderator.
We'll be able to answer his questions in a few minutes. Thank you very much, Randall. We'll invite our panelists to the stage now, and I'm going to apologize in advance for the pronunciation of some of the names. But from Argentina, Martin Rosenhar. From Europe, Andy Dury. Please come and take a seat. From Ethiopia, Mr. Yilma. From Australia, Francois Darcas. From China, Feng Ying Yang. Help me with that. Come on forward. From Egypt, Mr. Adlam Wili. And from Turkey, Asaf Konka. And the one I know the best, my friend Judd Keller from the USA. Judd. There's only 4 microphones, gentlemen, ladies. So we'll have to share those as we move through your comments, but please take a seat. I think we'll just start and go right down the line. Tell us a little bit about yourself, the area you represent, and any comments you have about the crop, the supply. We'd like to learn more about your particular region. So if you'd like to use this, come on forward.
Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know if this works. Due to the expectation that generates the presentation regarding pulses of Argentina, we are going to introduce a brief summary of what happened with this production in the last years. To that end, we will start with the campaign of 2013, when the great drought of such year caused the loss of almost all the bean crop of our country, which resulted in economic and contract compliance damages. Being one of the main suppliers of this product, we cannot fail to mention the generated distortion for this reason in the market. The damage affected that campaign and also moved to the next one, due to the fact that the loss of the seed causes serious difficulties in 2014 for the loss of great part of the genetic material that allowed our typical quality. The consequences was a reasonable crop, but with great quality problems, which resulted in a very low process performance. And we reach now to this year, when the drop in prices of almost all the agricultural commodities are positioned in the most lowest levels of the last year, adding to export taxes and very overdue exchange rate, high internal cost and severe export seizures translated it in an explosive cocktail when the producers had to take decision regarding which crops to choose that would leave certain income. The options were A, the traditional commodities of lower or no rent, or B, pulses. After the field survey and studies carried out at almost 30 days of the sowing, there is no doubt that the decision taken by the majority of the growers was to increase the sowing areas with pulses. This graphic shows the total sowing of alubia beans that shows us that almost at 25% higher than the last year average with 165,000 hectares. Black beans sowing at about 75% more than the average of last year with almost 109,000 hectares. With almost 19 hectares, the cranberry sowing is one of the highest in the past 5 years. The red beans also increase in the area with a total of 32,000 hectares, which 17,000 belong to light red kidneys and 15,000 to dark red kidneys. And all this determines that the assigned area for beans shall be 431,000 hectares for this campaign if we add the other beans not shown in these figures, such as canela, redondo, atsuki beans, mungo beans, among others. The sowing have been staggered due to the absence or excess of water, and in the typical bean areas, such sowing ended very late with the consequent risk of frost during the end of their cycle. For the time being, most of the fields are in good condition, most of it in its flowering period, but more than 2 months remains ahead. Taking into account average yields, and if no inclement weather occurs, the exportable amount of each of the varieties shall be as follows. These figures, of course, are estimated, at the moment, at least. Alubia beans, 150,000 tons are the amount we expect. Black beans with 190,000 tons. Cranberry beans with 17,000 tons. And red beans with 28,000 tons, which 15 belongs to light red and 13 to dark red. Coming to the end, an issue of concern to us within the situation generated as of the draft of 2013, which we have already mentioned, was the impact that the shortage of alubia beans and other Argentinian pulses had in the market. The rising, which in some contracts reached up to $1,800 cost and freight Mediterranean ports, was rapidly restrained by the appearance of other origins. Added to this was the lack of quality of the Argentinian pulses. We reiterate that this was caused due to the loss of our standard genetic seed, which in a short period of time resulted in a disorganized ongoing depression of prices. In view of this situation, the buyers of some destinations unilaterally started to renegotiate the closed contracts with sellers always in a disadvantaged condition as given by the shipped goods or in destination ports, causing them, apart from the loss of their renegotiation, extremely high extra cost if it was expected to protect the product by reselling it, especially due to these destinations where they were found. Added to this was the uncountable quantity of inconvenience caused by the Argentinian customs, commercial and exchange legislation, which did nothing other than increase the losses. Argentina has all the conditions to become again the reliable supplier of pulses that was always been. We hope that the climatic conditions will not be as severe as the recent past, but we also expect from our clients the responsibility and seriousness that always was claimed in these meetings. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next, Andy Burry is going to talk to us a little bit about the situation in around Europe. Andy.
Okay, hi, I'm Andy Berry from Frontier Agriculture. My main business is trading faba beans from the UK principally with the main markets to Middle East, particularly Egypt, with feed beans trading into feed production for fish farming, as well as a little bit of other cattle and pig. What I'd just like to go through today is a little bit about why the faba bean acreage is growing. Some of the numbers, I think, previously slightly wrong and maybe need to be looked at again. To think a little bit about Egypt, which is clearly the market driver for faba beans from the premium market, and also the biggest buyer, but some of the issues in Egypt regarding the finance and foreign exchange issues there. And perhaps for all the growing countries to look a bit harder for some of the traders at alternative markets for faba beans, starting with aquaculture, before we look at perhaps some of the other less inclusive animal feed products. So looking at the slide, I don't know if you can see the numbers at the back, but we're certainly seeing a growth in acreage for a number of reasons. From the UK to my home territory, if we just look to the far right numbers, we look as though we're going up to somewhere in the region of 25%, probably 500,000 tons of faba beans this year. They're in the ground, they're planted, and growing well. French a little bit behind us, but that's not unusual. They're looking at a slight increase of somewhere in the region of 15%. Australia is a big question mark, and I'll let my friend Francois Descartes fill in a bit more detail there. Interested growth in Canada, which is in a region that I've not been involved in, but it's going to be an interesting challenge. Marketing faba beans, I've seen some of the quality of faba beans from this harvest, and there's a few quality issues to go to be rectified before they can meet into the Egyptian market. And we're also seeing quite an interesting growth close to the UK in the Baltic states, Poland, Lithuania, Sweden we put in there, and I think further into the former Soviet Union as well. So we are seeing quite a big increase, and we potentially will going to see somewhere in the region of 1.4 million tons of faba beans worldwide. And these beans will not stay mostly in their own country. A lot of them are exported around the world. And really, it's all about why we're seeing this growth. And it's, as ever, farmers' planting intentions are not driven by some great esoteric value of idea of just let's grow beans because they're good for everybody. It's all about the dollars. And when we see low canola values and the returns that farmers are getting there, we see issues in Europe, particularly with weed control problems, where farmers have been growing continuous crops, or they've been growing winter crops of wheat canola. They've got to give the ground a break. So weed control is very important. And from a European perspective, European agricultural policy reform is encouraging the growth and the development of faba beans and peas. We have great rules in Europe. We've got a clever little thing called an ecological focus area where farmers are obliged to have 5% of their land either set aside or they can grow nitrogen-fixing crops, which has obviously played well into the hands of the growth of pulses. So that's why we're seeing this growth and development, and I guess it's at rest in other parts of the world as well. But the main market is no doubt is Egypt, and Egypt is the main driver. And it's Egypt which effectively sets the value, but it's Egypt which also gives us some of the issues in terms of trading and price establishment of pulses. The graph, which is probably not so easy to see, but the dark blue band is a French crop, which is the volume of exports going into Egypt, which we have seen a reduction. There have been a number of issues on quality over the last couple of years. I think French farmers have tended to look to pulses, to peas, perhaps rather than to continue on with faba beans. The UK, we've seen a rise. It's just sort of tailed off a little bit, but we are seeing a big rise. Farmers are getting to grips with growing faba beans. And in the years when we didn't have many grown, I think the few farmers left behind who were growing them got much better. And I think that knowledge is improving and moving on. But the biggest issue with Egypt at the moment, as other traders will be aware, is the issue of Egyptian customers, our customers, getting hold of hard dollars in order to effect those purchases. And foreign exchange issues and lack of hard dollars is an ongoing problem. And clearly, there will be a restriction on the imports of various products, not just faba beans, but all food products and hard goods as well. One would expect that, and there has certainly been support from the Egyptian government supporting the importers as an essential food importers in order to keep essential food coming into the country. And they have had preferential arrangements been made, but those need to continue if we want to see the establishment of new crop. And very quickly, to finish, just the last slide, aquaculture is a growing demander of faba beans. Aquaculture has grown hugely over the previous 15 years. We've seen 6% growth year on year. We're seeing it dip off now to about 3%. But production areas in Norway, North America, and Chile, very, very strong demand. And those are the guys who are going to take faba beans, particularly when they're dehulled, as an incredibly useful product, up to an inclusion of about 11% as a binder in a salmon food market. They need to have a binder to hold the protein and the fat together in a very dense and highly nutritious pellet, and faba beans do this perfectly. And I think we'll see a potential increase in demand around the world as buyers look for further use for faba beans. So there we have it. That's my sort of overview on the market. I'm sure we'll have some discussions later on about price and price establishment. But at the moment, I'll hand over to Francois. Thank you.
From Australia, Francois.
Good morning. I didn't come prepared with a slide, but Andy Burry did an excellent job in summarizing world trends for faba beans, so it's not much to add. I will just comment on the Australian perspective. We had last year, or this crop year, a large reduction in our crop. We went from a crop in 13-14 of about 450,000 tons to only about 280 in 14-15. Mostly due to a very dry spring and a drastic drop in yields from about 2.5 tons per hectare to 1.5 tons per hectare, despite a growth in area, growth estimated at about 15%. As a result, our exports this crop year are dropping significantly from a total of 370,000 tons last year to only about 230,000 tons this year. That's forecast. The year is not over yet. The main market is Egypt, as Andy said, and I forecast total exports to Egypt this year will only be 160,000 tons against 240 last year. Looking at our next crop, it's very early to really accurately forecast what our crop will be. We will be sowing the crop in the next 2 months. The intentions from growers are to increase again acreage probably by another 15%. And that's as a result of very good prices for the last several years and also much more reliability in production. So the excellent job by Perch Australia in helping growers learn about growing faba beans and Perch's crops in general, the improvement varieties have made faba beans a much more consistent production for farmers, and this together with higher prices is really pushing them to grow more, not only faba beans, but all pulses. And also the same reason as in the UK, Australian farmers traditionally have a rotation of wheat and canola, and they need to introduce something else to break the cycle and weed management. And they're more and more realizing too that faba beans are excellent for their soils, and they generally end up with much better yields the year after in wheat or canola, whatever they grow. So we forecast another increase in acreage. This being said, it is very dry, as Peter Wilson said this morning about red lentils. So the next 4 weeks will be crucial in realizing those intentions. If it doesn't rain, that increase may not happen. And as far as crop size, that's where it's really too early to say. As I said earlier, we had yields of 2.5 tons a hectare last year, only 1.5 this year. We will start the crop year with drier conditions than last year. So I'll give you a range in crop size. I think we could see again a crop as low as mid 200s, 250 on low yields. But our crop has the potential to be over 500,000 tons if we go back to the yields of the year before, say 2.5 tons. What's also happening is that the faba beans production is expanding into new areas that are more reliable in terms of rainfall and also that have access to irrigation water. So overall, we could see average yields a bit less volatile and more consistent, and that would push crop forecast towards the high end of my numbers. So that's all I have to say. But the conclusion is that the market is working, high prices are pushing farmers to grow more, and weather permitting, we will have a big production in Australia this coming year. Thank you.
Thank you. Judd Keller on the USA.
In looking at the 2015 crop estimates for the US and Canada, we're seeing very little change in projected acres. Keeping in mind that the crop is not planted yet, these are just estimates people have put out. So right now the data would say maybe a 1 to 2% increase in acres. The differential is it's going to depend on the variety, what the impact was. If you're looking at pinto beans, you're looking at crop that's probably gonna be down 7 to 10% in acres. If you're looking at black beans, and we saw that on the International Food Trader data, you're looking at, we're estimating maybe 26% up. Navy beans, a small increase, probably 4 to 5%. Great Northerns, there'll be a large drop, could be as high as 36% or more. Part of that is by design. There was a big push to plant Great Northerns during the large white bean disaster starting in 2013. And now that we see that the large white bean market seems to be turning around as far as production, we do not need to be producing that many Great Northerns. So we're in the step of actually producing less and trying to bring supply demand for U.S. and Canadian product into a more stable situation. Dark red kidneys, if you look at the U.S., we're calling it maybe 8% up. Part of that is due to shortage on seed. There's just not enough seed to increase any production. There's a lot of growers that would like to plant it, but again, seed is not available. The other side, granted it's a smaller acreage number, but the Canadian stats I've gotten from colleagues in Canada say their dark red kidneys will be up about 30%, but then again, in proportion to U.S. productions, it's smaller. Looking on cranberry beans, we're looking, again, you saw the same thing in International Food Traders data. We're looking at that to be anywhere from 5 to 10% off. Again, it's part of that is a lack of availability of cranberry seed. And kind of rolling back to that, it used to be traditionally Idaho was the big seed producing state. Now there's a lot of seed being produced in Wyoming. And during the harvest of 2014, we had a hard freeze in parts of Wyoming, and that damaged some of the seed inventories that were being produced. So next year, they'll have to recover from that. The cupboard's bare at this point for several different bean varieties. If we look at light red kidneys, nominally both Canada and U.S., maybe about a 5% increase. Again, we have farmers who want to plant them, but just no seed available. And if I take a look at the final one, small reds, that's another variety that is increasing. We, for several years, had a large inventory we had to kind of burn away, and finally this last year it was kind of burned away, and now we're back in a balance. We're seeing an increase in demand. Again, using International Food Traders data, you could see increase in red bean consumption, be it small reds, light red kidneys, dark red kidneys, so forth. So you're going to see probably about a 22% increase in that. And again, I have to emphasize, this is preliminary numbers. These are numbers in talking to Canadian traders and so forth. And we're also using the USDA initial crop estimates, acreage estimates. So it's a ballpark. Until it gets planted, it's one thing. And in the long run, until it gets put in the barn after it's harvested, then it's the real thing. And looking at the overall situation in the U.S., we've had the pleasure, there's a Browning newsletter, and they specialize in presenting data on weather and climate changes and so forth. And they take into account volcanic action, dirt that's thrown in the air and so forth and how it affects everything, El Nino, La Nina, and all these different effects. And in the presentations they've given, it looks like California's water situation will continue with the drought. And with that, we've seen a drastic drop in black eye and large lima and baby lima production, more so in the large limas and the black eyes. In other areas, according to the projections they've given us, and of course, weather can always change, it looks like we're going to have fair or average type weather in most of the central bean growing areas. Keep in mind that certain areas are more dependent on well water, you know, for irrigated crops, and at least I know in Nebraska and Colorado at this point in time, though we've been theoretically in drought for many, many years, the growers are telling us that there doesn't seem to be any kind of cutback on their ability to pump water. So, and like I said, it looks like we have a carryover from last year. You may see it's hard to throw prices out now. Not many contracts are being signed. I know there's probably some numbers floating in the marketplace, but a lot depends on the grower. And at this point in time, the grower prices are not looking that good to the growers as far as profitability. They've had the pleasure of five very good years, but then everything in the agricultural industry cycles, and we're on a downward cycle on the pricing. Another thing we're looking at as far as the export side is the U.S. dollar has become very strong. And it seems most everybody that we deal with, we're someplace between 20 and 40% differential because of the strong U.S. dollar. So if I look back over the years of the size of the crop they're putting this year, it's kind of just a, kind of an average size crop, and that's probably what we need for this year. So thank you.
Thank you, Judd. From Egypt? Adlam Awele.
Good morning. First, I would like to take a few seconds to acknowledge you, the tragic loss that my company has suffered recently as my partner and cousin has suddenly passed away in a car accident 15 days ago. He should have been here with me today, but I'm sure he's resting in peace and in a better place. Since the time of pharaohs, Egypt depended on agriculture. In fact, we attribute the commencement of the ancient Egyptian civilization to agriculture, as they produced surplus crops through their ability to predict flooding of the Nile River and control irrigation of the fertile valley. In modern-day Egypt, one of the top-grown crops is the white kidney beans. Up to the eruption of the 2011 revolution, the agricultural sector was one of the most stable and resilient sectors in the economy, witnessing growth ranging from 2.5 and 3% annually during the last few years. The white beans is cultivated throughout the entire year and is harvested twice a year, once at the end of May, beginning of July, and once at the end of November, beginning of December. Average productivity is 1.2 metric tons per fedan. Mainly, I will discuss the beans from three perspectives. Overview of the crop in terms of cultivation. Exports increased from 75,000 metric tons in 2012-2013 to 130,000 metric tons in 2013-2014. This evident increase in the second season was due to the large drop in Argentinian crop, which was a result of weather conditions at their end, and hence led to a significant price increase in Egypt and turn was an incentive to the Egyptian farmer to grow large quantities of the white bean crop. In order to seize this price increase opportunity to the fullest in season 2014-2015, the Egyptian farmers took many measures, including the utilization of all available land for the cultivation of the product, to attain higher rates of productivity, as well as increasing spending on the servicing of the product and the land to produce a crop of more superior quality. Overview of crop in terms of processing. As previously mentioned, this increase in productivity obligated the improvement of processing from manual sorting to mechanical sorting, an effort to meet the new export demand for high-quality white bean. Most of the producers had to upgrade to electronic color sorters, which led to a crop that meets European standards, specifically 180 to 190 per 100 grams. Overview in terms of commerce and logistics. The current season, Algeria is known to be the largest consumer of white beans. This is all his estimations, consuming approximately 25%, followed by Iraq and Turkey about 15% each, while the rest of the Arab region roughly consume 20%. The remaining consumption is by Eastern and Western Europe. As previously mentioned, Egypt's bean exports have increased in season 2014-2015 to about 130 metric tons from a total harvest for export of 150,000 metric tons, mainly due to its centralized and strategic geographic location, which leads to faster delivery of the product to foreign consumers and hence increases their turnover rates. Moreover, with this increase in exports in Egypt and the return of Argentina to the beans market in season 2014-2015, there was a noted increase in supply worldwide and a lack of demand, which led to a decline in prices from $1,700 to $850 at the beginning of the current season. Having an excess supply, roughly about 20,000 metric tons in Egypt, and accordingly to the above mentioned statistics, it can be easily expected that the increase in demand for the white bean will now shift to the local market, as the price decline will lead to a competitive price advantage over its substitutes, such as black eyed peas. This will further hold as we approach the holy month of Ramadan, in which consumption and distribution of legumes in general increases with preference of the cheapest. Last but not least, forecast for the coming season could be that export will not surpass about 120,000 to 130,000 metric tons. However, the high quality product will be maintained and Egypt's competitive advantage is not going anywhere. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Yilma from Ethiopia.
Thank you very much. My name is Theodros Yilma. I'm from Ethiopia. I'll be giving you a short outlook about Ethiopian pulses production, export, and export. As you well know, Ethiopia, as an emerging country, has become a very important country in the production and export of pulses. Over the past few years, we can say below a million tons, we have reached now to produce around 3 million tons of pulses. Among this, of course, the color beans, like the red kidney beans, the white pea beans, the pinto, the faba beans, all these, among others, are produced in Ethiopia and exported. Ethiopia exports to almost 75 countries. We export, for example, red kidney beans have been mentioned in the first presenter, have become a big supplier from Africa. We exported from in 2013 to 2014, up to 2014, within our calendar year from June, July, that means 2013-2014, red kidney beans, we exported 76,000 metric tons. White pea beans, around 59,000 metric tons. Pinto beans exported around 30,000 metric tons. In this 2014-2015, within only 8 months, Ethiopia exported around 63,000 metric tons of red kidney beans, 29,000 metric tons of white pea beans, and 14,000 metric tons of pinto beans. When we look at the production, we have a very big number, especially in faba beans. As you have seen maybe in the first presenter, he mentioned around 500,000 tons, which in fact the numbers we have is around 700,000 metric tons faba beans Ethiopia produces. Out of this, maybe around 50,000 tons we export and the other is locally consumed. When we see the red kidney beans and white pea beans, between red kidney beans and white pea beans, we produce around 250,000 tons and the rest, LSKB, RSKB, cream beans, and pinto, is around 200,000 metric tons. We have also a large number of production in chickpeas. Maybe it will be presented in the afternoon from another presenter from Ethiopia. So Ethiopia has become a very important country in the export. And among the countries Ethiopia is exporting is, the biggest importer is Pakistan, covering around 18% of export out of Ethiopia. Sudan is the next one, the second one, and India is the third, and Nicaragua is the fourth one, country importing Ethiopian pulses. Between these numbers, Ethiopia has become a very important exporter of pulses to the world. And with a plan is, of course, between our production and the government plan is to increase the export and the production every year, so to become the big player in the pulses industry. So in conclusion, as Ethiopia becoming a very important exporter, to see the industry, to see Ethiopia as an option. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, I will look at it when we go to the questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And from Turkey, Asf Konja.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to speak about all beans from the general and to special. According to the statistic date, worldwide grain production is about 21.1 million tons. And from this amount, Turkey has only 1% of share of the world grain production. The beans production has its share with 17% of Turkey's total legumes production, which are mainly harvesting from Konya, Karaman, and Niğde places. The planting time in Turkey for the all beans in April and May. The harvesting time in August and September. The usually annual production in Turkey for white beans, 110 and 120,000 metric tons. If we figure latest 3 years, I can share the information with you, which is 2012 years, we had 80,000 metric tons production. And 2013, we had production 70,000 metric tons. And latest year, which is 2014, we had 115,000 metric tons production. And we've seen the production became increased last year. Consumption, as I say to you, which is 120,000 metric tons approximately, and we are consuming all this quantity, which is not only Turkish, it is also other types of the different origins. If I figure import and export rates, Turkey's annual beans imports are around 75,000 metric tons. Turkey's imports around 80,000 tons of beans from major suppliers countries, which are Kyrgyzstan, Egypt, Argentina, Canada, USA, and China. Volume of 40% of this imports consumed in local markets in Turkey. And 60% of remaining amount, which is about 45,000-50,000 metric tons for re-export. Iraq is one of the biggest customer countries. For the information of 2015, seeding will be and planting time will be start in April and May for the new crop. We are expecting that the seeding could be 10 and 20% lower than last year planted areas because of the beans price were low in 2014. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you. And concluding the global presentation, Feng from China.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Feng Jingliang from Hainan Taikoo Series Oils Trade Company. It's my pleasure to be here to share the Chinese pearls beans market information with all of you. As you know, the Chinese mainly export beans, including light speckled kidney beans, dark red kidney beans, black beans, white beans. Annually exporting quantity is around, varies from 500,000 metric tons to 800,000 metric tons. Let me give you a brief introduction of them. First, let's talk about light speckled kidney beans, long shape. In the season of 2013 to 2014, the price reached the highest level at around $16,000 per metric ton and ended at around $1,000 FOB. Encouraged by the high price, the farmers encouraged their planting acres in 2014 almost as twice as in 2013. And they had a very good harvest, and the production is around 200,000 metric tons. But the big quantity results in a very low price this year. From the price dropped down from 950 at the beginning to 740 now. However, the low price has depressed the farmers, and so most of the farmers and the collectors are preferring to take the position or storing the good quality light speckled kidney beans in the freeze warehouse and waiting for the high price or wait until the new season coming. So now the available good quality light speckled kidney beans in our market is around only 10,000 metric tons, I think. Also, the farmers this year, they will reduce the planting acre in the coming planting season, say in May. So the selling of the seeds is very weak now. Secondly, let's say dark red kidney beans in China. There are two main origins, Shanxi origin and the Heilongjiang origin. The total production in 2014 is around 45,000 tons, the exporting quantity. The price for crop 2013 was also very high at around $3,150. But for the new crop to 2014, the price has come down to $1,550 now. But for the dark red kidney beans, now the Chinese market has begun to consume it. So there are some quantity are consumed in our domestic market, which is around 10,000 metric tons. The planting acre won't be much different from that in 2014, and there are still some stock in the farmer's hand. As the black beans also, just like the light speckled kidney beans, the high price also encouraged the farmers to increase the planting acres in 2014. But the total production is around 150,000 metric tons. But the price also come down to around 740, while for crop 2013, the price was around 1,100. And also the current price is also around 740, something like that. Also, the same, the farmers or the collectors, they also store most of the stock, most of the black beans in hand and wait maybe for another 1 or 2 years. And the available quantity in the market is also around 20,000 to 30,000 metric tons. And the price for the stock for the black beans which was taken position, their cost is around $750. For the white beans, there are various white beans in China. The mainly is like Baisake, Japanese white, Alumbier type, navy white, and large white Yunnan region. This year, Baisake is the best seller in China because the price is also come down from $1,000 to $900 now. And the white Japanese type and the Alubia types, they found a very bad or hard position this year in China because of the small demand and the less competitive price. But navy beans, now they have a very good sale in Chinese local market because of the low price. And the large white beans Yunnan region, they face the same situation as the dark red kidney beans. They have the stable harvest and lower price than last year. And so they also found the local market consumption. And just the quantity is almost the same as their exporting quantity. Also, the low price this year will reduce the planting acre in 2015. To summary, 2015 is a very difficult year for Chinese farmers exporters. The low price and the weak demand has hit both of them. According to the information we've got now, we would have a very small year for crop 2015 for all kinds of beans. The farmers now, they have expressed their idea to reduce the planting acre for 2015, and they will prefer to plant like corn and wheat or soybeans instead of the kidney beans. So the production for crop 2015 is not so optimistic. So, thank you.
Thank you very much to all the panelists. If we could have the house lights brought up, I think I've got a couple of questions, but maybe we'll start with a question or two from the audience.
My first question, I guess, is for Martin. I saw the hectares planted up there, and I guess the question is how conservative you were with the yields. It seemed to me that the yields for the tonnage seemed like it was a very conservative estimate based on historical averages.
Well, you have to take in account that there is no remaining seed. We are talking about exports, not just production in the figures. So we have to take in account the remaining seed and the lost in the process, the losses of the process. That's why maybe you feel that it's conservative. Anyway, general average of pulses in Argentina, it's around 1,200 to 1,300 kilos per hectare. So you are not so far away from that figure.
Okay. Thank you. Another question. We've got one over here.
Atif Tedros from Egypt. I would like to thank Andy Berry for his very good speech on FABES. And I would like to deliver to him a message about the exchange rate of dollar availability in Egypt. What the Egyptian government or Central Bank of Egypt did in 5th of February this year to limit the black market of trading dollars. So they just ask it every individual or company to buy the dollar from the bank in a queue with priority to three things: food, fuel, and medicine. Concerning food, faba bean is coming number one in the queue, faba bean and lentil. So there is no worries whatsoever on payment of faba beans and lentil when your customer will have document at bank, I can assure you, and do not queue now for more than 1 week. It's a clarification if Andy would like to ask or to have a clear, please.
Thank you very much for that clarification. And certainly, if that removes some of the concern from the exporters of all agricultural products, but certainly from my case, our case of faba beans to Egypt, then that's certainly going to give some reassurance. I guess long term, it is a requirement upon Egypt to continue to earn dollars as a country as a whole. And that's clearly a case for any country that needs to have a reserve of foreign exchange. But with faba beans being up in the beginning at the front of the list, that does give us hope and reassurance that we'll see the situation be more flexible in terms of access to dollars for our customers in the coming months, and certainly looking forward to the new crop situation that eases and makes the process a lot easier for everybody. But thank you.
Okay, my question is for Mr. Francois Darcas. He mentioned in his speech that pushing up prices in Australia is encouraging growers in whole Australia, in addition to some new area with better climate for the faba beans. But what's his opinion? As Andy said, there is now a lot of production. Newcomers are coming, like Lithuania, like Canada, some European countries, and they are trying to have better crop, good quality, except for Canada so far. Canada is not as good, but Lithuania and European countries are trying to improve quality. Prices of Europe so far, we heard, and both Francois and Andy can correct me, so low to a price of 360 bulk in vessel landed to Egypt. Will Australia, my question, continue to have high prices with big difference between European prices and Australian prices? What do you think?
Thank you, Atef. That's a very good question. I think Australian faba beans have a core demand in Egypt and will command a premium over European beans for quality reasons. Now, that premium will fluctuate with supply and demand. In a year where there's ample supply of Australian fabas, I think that premium is usually to a maximum of $50 a ton. This past year, we saw, with a much reduced Australian crop, we saw Australian trading pretty much the whole year at over $100 a ton premium over UK and French. So it really depends. If we go back for a smaller crop like we had this year, 250,000 tons, I think that premium will remain. If we realize the potential of increased acreage and better yields, and we go back to a crop like last year, 450, maybe half a million tons, then certainly that premium will shrink, I think. But we were surprised this year. Nobody thought Australian beans would trade all year at $100 plus premium, and it did. So the question is, how large is that demand for that core demand in Egypt for the Australian quality? And that's an answer I don't have, and that the market will tell us that in coming years, I guess.
Other questions? I guess we have one in the back.
Hi, just on Ethiopia, what do we see for the potential for expansion or production there, other new varieties and potential investment opportunities?
Well, right now, as I have earlier mentioned, our production is increasing every year, and new products and quality improvements are being given attention by the government as well. Our research centers are working hard to get a better variety of different kind of pulses and new varieties to come into to reach into the hands of the farmers. As you know, Ethiopia is an agrarian economy. 80% of the population is a farmer. The whole economy is depending on agriculture. So it's very important also even for the government to give the attention to increase the production, increase the quality, and also to bring in new varieties. So it's underway. So in the coming years, we may see also new varieties coming in into the market.
Thank you. In the back of the room, no? I had a question, and I guess I'll direct it to anyone that cares to answer. Maybe Judd could start, but it would appear to me that speckled bean consumption around the world is drifting. And of course, we're most familiar, Judd, with pinto beans. Have you noticed that? And what are your thoughts on that?
I believe so, that our supply-demand scenario for pinto beans in the U.S. is changing. And I think there's two major factors, and one is a very volatile factor. We used to export quite a bit to Mexico, and they've developed varieties. We no longer have that niche for that premium bean that used to go in there. So we're more dependent now upon the size of the Mexican crop. There are years when they have a very poor crop, and we have the opportunity to ship a lot of pintos there. So now we have a market there that can vary anywhere from, I don't know, I'll call it 10,000 metric tons to 100,000 metric tons, depending how well the Mexican crop does. And Mexico has had very good crops in the last 2 years, and we've seen very little demand based on that. I would say the other factor to take a look at is we've had a large increase in the consumption of black beans in the U.S. I recall back 25 years ago, we used to use, and I'm having to think to convert this into metric because I think in hundredweights. But we used to consume domestically maybe 20,000 metric tons of black beans. And I'd say over the last 2 years, now the latest estimates I'm hearing by the trade is someplace around 115 or 120,000 metric tons. And I believe part of that came at the expense of the consumption of pinto beans. In other words, people changed from eating pintos and started eating more black beans. And that was part of that.
Thank you. Anyone else care to comment on the speckled bean consumption in your region? I wondered about Africa, Angola, for example.
What's that?
Angola, for example.
Well, originally with Angola, they've now become somewhat of a U.S. market, and I think they have a preference for both Canadian and U.S. pinto beans. There's a phrase that they use in Angola called espera cunhado. And that refers to waiting for your brother-in-law. And the idea behind that is the beans cook quickly, and then your brother-in-law leaves quickly. So that's the theory. So there used to be a lot of competition with light-speckled kidney beans out of China. That market went skyrocketing and kind of gave us a break on being able to export at reasonable prices into Angola. Now we're looking at Angola with the situation with the oil. They're a large exporting country of oil, so we really have to see what they are. They can vary from year to year on how much they import. I would call them for the U.S., they're probably now anywhere from second to third market, depending on the year, for exports.
This is for Feng, our speaker from China. You mentioned that there would be a significant drop in production in 2015, was expected for dry beans, or that was my understanding. And I'm trying to figure out, in the other countries we're seeing, in Argentina and the United States, we've seen an increase in production of dry beans because the corn and soybeans, the alternatives, just are not attractive to the growers right now. And I'm wondering why it's different in China.
Yes. Yeah, I mentioned in my speech, I really mentioned the drop planting acres for the crop to the 2015. We can see it from the evidence of the selling seeds now. Is the farmers, they are willing to buy the seeds very weak, and it's really a very small sale for the seed. The planting time is coming in May. Now, what they are thinking is to plant corn and soybeans or wheat, because they will have more income for each acre. That's why they will prefer to drop down the dry beans planting acres. And the main reason of this is the low price. The low price in 2015 or for crop 2014. So also they have many stock in hand for the good quality. So I mean the light speckle, but the good quality stock is not much. And most of the people, they will take the position or store the beans in hand, like black beans, white beans, and light speckled kidney beans. Yes, hope I have answered your question.
Feng, just to add to that, I think you mentioned in your talk a little bit about planting season and timing. Is it easy to capture when China plants their crop? Or is it so vast that they're planting beans all the time? My question is simply, when does China plant its bean crop? Is it in May? Is it in what month of the year do you plant?
There's only one time in China, in May.
It's May?
Yeah, in May.
Okay, I just wanted to be clear about that. Thank you. Other questions? If not, please join me in thanking our panelists. They awesome job. Thank you.
All right, I would like to thank our guests and our panelists from the Global Beans Outlook. You guys did an outstanding job, and our moderator, Joe Kramer.